So before we go on, let's talk a little bit, just to make sure we're all on the same page, about how we define culture. I've said over and over again, but I'm still frustrated that people don't get it. Culture is not something that we do. We don't create a culture. We don't say next month we will have a more customer-oriented culture. Culture is a product of what we do. It's a product of learning. Culture is like personality or character. It's what we are, based on our histories and our experiences. So organizations are cultures. They are the product of what they have been. So when you say, well, what is our culture or what should it be? The first step is to say, well, let's figure out what our experience so far has taught us to be. Before we raise the question of what we should be, we have to find out what we are. Just as if somebody says, you know, you should be a different personality or you should have different character, you have to start with where you are. And when you try to think about this, you have to think about these different levels. At the top level, this is the iceberg model, simplified. At the top level, you have what's visible. Companies or personalities are what we see, what we experience, how they talk, the architecture. One of my favorite cultural artifact experiences, if I may just take a moment, was when I was both working for Digital Equipment Corporation, a wild entrepreneurial electrical engineering computer company in the U.S., where if you walked into the building, everything was chaotic. Wide open office architecture, dining rooms in the middle of office spaces. No one had doors on their offices because the entrepreneur, Ken Olson, didn't really believe that one should have doors because it destroyed communication. And next month, I was flying over on Swiss Air to Basel to consult with Siba Geigy. And the number of heavy German doors that I had to go through to get to anyone was about as different from digital as you could imagine. Now, was this U.S. Germany? Partly. Was it digital versus Siba Geigy? Partly. And had a huge impact. But what's true of artifacts is that they have an impact, but you don't know why. Why did Siba Geigy have all these damn heavy doors? And why did digital have no doors? So artifacts don't tell you enough. They tell you there's a difference here. But to get to the difference, you really have to look at the espoused values. What's underneath? And so you go to both of these organizations and say, well, why don't you have doors in digital? And they'll say, because it destroys communication. Okay. And then you go to Siba Geigy and say, why do you have all these doors? Because that's the only way we can work. Now, they've given you their value system, but you haven't really figured out the difference. And that tells you there must be some deeper assumption about work and communication. And so when you push farther, and this takes time and group meetings and digging into it, you discover that the people in digital say, well, we're inventing a new technology. Nobody knows how it's going to work. Circuits are things you can play around with. So the only way we can get good decisions is by everybody arguing and talking and constantly interacting until finally some idea survives the debate, and then we will know that's the decision we have to make. And to them, it's very clear. Communication is the bedrock of work and the only way to make decisions, and you have to have an open debate. And then you go to Siba Geigy and ask the same question, and they look at you as if you're stupid. They say, how else can you make decisions if you're dealing with chemical compounds, unless you fully know exactly how the chemical compounds work, and that means you study your books and you talk to experts and you sit in your office and you figure it out. Why? Because if you make mistakes, you get explosions and bad smells. So chemistry and electrical engineering are not the same. They have different occupational mentalities. The chemical engineer lives in an entirely different world from the electrical engineer. And it begins to be clear that in Sebag Aige, the important thing is not communication, but thought, careful thought. Or if you need help, you go to another expert who knows a little bit more than you do. And all this reflects the technology of chemistry. So to understand a culture, you need to get at these underlying assumptions of why we are organized the way we are in the first place and what it's all about. And if you don't understand those assumptions, then you don't really truly understand the organization or the technology, because that then also leads you to cultural DNA, what we think of as sort of the core principle. Now, you try to build a list, you know, how many core principles can there be? Think about the human landscape, all the different kinds of organizations that exist. Some of them, clearly, mostly the businesses of the world, have as their cultural DNA making profit for a service that they're providing to the community, sort of the fundamental business model. But if there's no profit, if you go out of business, then somehow you have failed in your fundamental function. And a second possibility is, no, it's not about making a profit. It's about providing primarily a service. You don't necessarily want to go broke, but making money is not your primary reason. Your primary reason is to deliver a service. So that would cover all the organizations that are in the nonprofits and government. And then you have many organizations whose fundamental DNA is we are creative, we are innovative, and if we cease to be creative or innovative, we're no longer ourselves. It's our fundamental identity. And interestingly, some young companies have as their primary DNA the innovation gene rather than the money gene. And that would explain the history of Digital Equipment Corporation. They started out inventing new computers and new ways of computing and were wildly successful for about 25 years because they were an innovation engine. Innovation was what they were good at. And then the market changed, and we got used to PCs and turnkey computers, and suddenly innovation was not so important. And digital said to itself, but that's who we are. We're going to continue to push the innovative products. We're not going to build junk like the IBM PC. And that destroyed them as an economic entity. They then became, unprofitable and were sold to Compaq, and eventually what was left of digital went into Hewlett-Packard. But if you say, how come such a successful company failed so badly? I think deep down, because they never had the money gene. That was never their primary fundamental driving force. And then the utilities, their primary goal, when I work with Con Edison in New York, you can feel that what matters above everything else, sometimes even matters more than safety, is reliability. You've got to keep the lights on. And if the lights go off, then we're not doing our job. And then, of course, you get to the nuclear industry, and you have the primary DNA truly is safety, because they recognize that if things become unsafe, then not only do we wreck other people's lives, but we destroy the industry. So when you think of that as a culture model, think of what's down there in the DNA, and will that in the future create problems for leaders of different priorities becoming important as the world shifts around those four forces that I identified. So that's an additional problem for leaders, and this is a kind of a summary then. If everything I've said so far is true, then leaders have to deal with growing multiculturalism, and more importantly, thinking of occupational cultures, they have to begin to think about alignment inside the organization among various subcultures, as well as creating the right kinds of microcultures. So let me talk a little bit about the subcultures, because these are important. I think there are basically three generic subcultures that have to be identified and recognize that it's not a question of which is the right one, but how do you get those subcultures aligned with each other? And the three that I think exist in some form in all organizations are these three. In every organization, there is the line, the production, the people who actually make the product, sell it, and are on the firing line. They are usually very conscious of the human factor. They believe in training. They know that they are the ones who deal with any kinds of surprises that may occur. They have to improvise when the way the design was designed didn't work. And they are kind of the guts of the organization. But in every organization, there will also be what I broadly labeled the engineering culture, which is all the people who think about the product design, the process design, the organizational design, who want to make the ideal bureaucratic design picture that will make everything work smoothly. And if you think about the DNA, the cultural DNA of that group, they would like to minimize the people. If they could automate everything and make everything by rule or by standard, that would be ideal, because people are the ones who make mistakes, who don't do it right. So from a designer's point of view, from an engineer's point of view, the best design is one that is people-proof. And the most people-proof is to have no people. Have the machine do it all, because the machine won't make a mistake. Now, we can caricature that and say, no, we have to humanize the engineer. Wrong. Because the engineer is doing his or her job of figuring out what is the optimum design. In the healthcare industry, there's a big debate now. How much should you standardize certain kinds of operations or certain kinds of routines for how to deal with patients? And the doctors yell and scream, no, you will take away my autonomy, you can't do that. But the designer of the hospital will say, but we have good evidence that if you do it this way and this way and this way, we will get better results. So they're right now, they're fighting, the operators and the engineers. And then over them all is the executive subculture, which is we've got to keep the ship afloat financially. We either have to make a profit, or at least we can't go out of business. the hospital has to survive. And so how do you put together the money management, the design, and the operations, recognizing that you need all three? That if you destroy any one of them and say, we don't need you, you will be a less effective organization. That is a huge challenge, I think, for leaders, because you have leadership in all of these subcultures, and they have to get aligned with each other. So all of that, I think, finally leads to these conclusions and a little bit about helping. I just put in here some examples of, we say, well, do all organizations have subcultures? Yes, they do. In the hospitals, it's the doctors, nurses, administrators, custodians. In manufacturing, it's engineers, sales, marketing, finance, and so on. So the generic ones exist, but they exist in different forms, in different kinds of industries. And that leads then to the further issue of, if those are multicultural units and they're small units, how do leaders begin to think about developing these microcultures that have to evolve in those microcultural teams? So the implications are that communication failures resulting from cultural misunderstanding are at the heart of safety and productivity issues. And if that's the case, formal leaders will not have the luxury in the future of face-to-face contact, which will make it much harder to do the multicultural things. They will have to manage multicultural groups. They will recognize that good decisions will depend on good communication, which will depend on high trust in all relationships, and that high trust will depend, here's where we close the loop, again, on helping across cultural boundaries, especially across ranks, because the authority issues are likely to be the most different in the different cultures. So what will this mean for leaders? What are the helping dilemmas? I think the reason we need a whole workshop tomorrow on helping is because in most cultures, unfortunately, we wouldn't like it to be this way, but the concept of an adult is someone who doesn't need help. So when we have to ask for help, it's often a culturally, it's a countercultural kind of event. It shouldn't have to happen. And when you think about leaders and leadership, the higher you go in the organization, the more you think it shouldn't happen. I'm now the boss, so I shouldn't need help. Because by being made the boss, that means I know everything. I can now tell everybody else what to do. And so it's very painful, I think, for a higher person to say, especially to a lower person, you know, I'm your boss, but I need your help. It's a countercultural thing to have to do. And because of that, from the leader's point of view, to develop the attitude that I can and must ask for help is probably even more difficult than to develop the skills of humble inquiry. Because we can easily accept the idea, yes, I know I will have to do that, but to actually feel it and to actually say, I'm actually going to have to go to this subordinate and say, what do I do now? How do I do this particular thing? Will be very, very difficult. Similarly, in offering help, I think one of the worst traps we fall into, and I think you will have seen this in your own experience, there's nothing more insulting to a subordinate than to offer help on something that the subordinate thinks he or she knows how to do. That is demeaning to the subordinate. Here, let me help you with that particular task. And the subordinate knows that he or she knows how to do it. So who the hell is the boss coming down here offering me help? It makes me feel diminished. And how often do we do that? We do it to our children. We offer to help them with stuff, and the kid hates it because the kid knows how to do that and thinks that the parent should know enough to know that I know how to do that. So don't insult me by offering me help in an area where I don't need help. So these are some of the traps of helping and why one needs to really think carefully about it. And that means what leaders will have to learn is how to create relationships where these vulnerabilities and offenses and angers and so on won't occur, where it'll be smoother, where we will trust each other, where we will be able to ask for help or offer help without offending or feeling bad about it, which will mean humble inquiry, creating cultural islands for learning, and dialogues of the kind I described before. And that finally leads back to the conclusion that the leader of the future will adapt to the global forces of change by understanding that both productivity and safety depend on open communication, which depends upon trust and a climate of effective giving and receiving help. So we got through it. Thank you.